Hello everyone. This is the second session of this week. We will keep going in our discussion about this in the regression method. Now, I will introduce spline. Spline is a linear, not linear. Spline is a regression function with polynomial basis. It is very similar to step function regression. Step function regression uses step functions as a basis. Instead, spline uses polynomial functions as a basis function. So spline is a kind of polynomial regression plus polynomial regression function plus the step function regression. Okay. Mathematically, it is expressed by like this. Y is equal to beta 0 plus beta 1 and C1 plus beta 2 C2 and blah 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 up to CK. Then each C1 and C2 and CK, they means the regression function for each of the the beans. In a similar way with step function regression, spline also first cut the whole range of X into several several beans using C1, let's say C1, C2, and C3, C4. Let's think about we have the five beans with four cut points. Within each bean, a polynomial function is defined instead of just a flat step function. So each bean is modeled by certain polynomial functions. Polynomial regression functions like this. Okay. So here, that's why each CK or this C function is a polynomial function with has the non-zero values within this interval, but zero values outside of this interval. In fact, any order of the polynomial function can be used for this spline, but usually we use in the third order cubic polynomial functions. Third order cubic polynomial functions are commonly used. So, if we divide X into several beans and fit each bean by different polynomial regression, it look like this. Some big problem. Okay, data point of the each bean. There are two beans here. Each bean may fit it well. However, but overall fitting is a bit weird because there's a discontinuity at this the cutoff point. It's not a good fitting at all overallly. In an overall sense, okay, because of this discontinuity. So in order to prevent such a discontinuity, we put constraints for continuity, which is it should be has a, this F1 and F2. This one is actually C1 and C2. In this case, C1 and C2. They should have the same value of the output at the cut point at C. Okay, then we can actually make this all overall line is the continuous. So with this constraint, we fit each bean with different polynomial functions. Okay. However, it is still not a good function. Because it's not smooth. In other words, it's not differentiable over the whole range. If we try to find out the differential line from this way, it will look like this. If we find this line from this way, then it will be looks like this. So there's no one single differentiated value, which means it's not differentiable. That's why it looks a bit weird. So finally, To make a feeding function smooth over the whole range, we put additional constraints for smoothness or differentiability at each point, cutoff point of the C. We make the actual value of the F1 or in the C1 and C2, the fitted line of the each bin should be equal, and also we enforce the first differentiated function, first derivative should be the equal, also the second derivative should be equal to, okay? Since we use the third order polynomial function, we just ask continuity up to the second order differentiation continuity. In general, for the this order, if we use this order in the polynomial, the continuity of d minus 1's so order differentiation will be required. Okay. Anyway, so this is the cubic spline. This is a cubic spline because we use the third order. Each bin is fitted by different cubic polynomial functions, and also 0 and 1, 2, 0, 0's order and first order, second order differentiation continuity should be satisfied. As a result, we can have a good fitting function over the whole range. So here, the issue is the cutoff point. The numbers and the location of these cutoff points are usually determined as like the regression of the step functions. Please record the previous slide. In general, this spline is more flexible than just ordinary polynomial regression because it uses the multiple polynomial functions. But it is less flexible than Lewis, okay? Because it has it uses the bins instead of estimating line for the all points. Okay, so up to now we have discussed about some method to include the non-linearity in the regression problem. Now we will see some the other methods to overcome high dimensionality of the data. So first one is principal component regression. Principal component regression, or PCR, is a regression with the principal components. Principal components are uncorrelated or orthogonal variables that explain the data. It is the kind of transforming the coordinate. For example, consider a data point at two-dimensional space, x1 and x2. Okay. It means that this point has the weight to the x1 toward this direction, and this direction is often noted by as a vector format 1, 0, okay, toward this direction. And also this point has a weight by x2 toward direction of 0.1. Along the 0.1. Here, 1.0 and 0.1, these are the axis of this coordinate system. However, by rotating this axis a bit more, by rotating this axis like this, so something like this, we can find out in the new axis, or we can make in the new coordinate system with the axis of, let's say, this axis is expressed by like this, v11 and v12, or this point is v21 and v22. Okay. In this case, x is expressed with its weight on this new axis. So in this case, we may think this weight is alpha 1 and this weight is alpha 2. Okay, this is the coordinate transformation. In PCR, we transform the coordinate. We transform this coordinate by finding a direction corresponding to the maximum variance or explaining the largest variance. Okay, let's see what it actually means. For example, let's consider this is a data. This is a data distribution over x1 and x2 coordinate system. The variance of the whole data set is explained by this is the variance. This data point actually shows the variance of the data. The variance of this data is explained by the variance along the x1, which is this variance. Okay? And also, it is explained by variance toward x2. That is this variance. Okay? However, none of the x1 and x2 is the maximal variance. It does not explain the maximal variance. Actually, one single axis that explains the maximal variance, because in this case, the maximal variance comes from this direction. So, one single direction that explains this maximal variance is this v1. V1 direction, okay? So then orthogonal to this direction, or the perpendicular to this direction, the next direction that explains the rest of the variance, maximal variance, that means the variance that is not explained by this direction is definitely this direction. Then this direction becomes the second axis, v2. Okay? So this v1 and v2 are a new coordinate that explains the maximal variance of the data. Okay? In this case, we call this the v1 is the first principal component, and this v2 is second principal component. Okay? In general, in the p-dimensional data, because this is the transformation of the data of the coordinate, p-dimensional data usually have p variables, also p principal component. Always, the first principal component is the direction of the maximal variance, and the second is orthogonal to the first one and also explains the maximal variance among the rest of them, and so on. The data point is transformed to this new coordinate system. So, for example, this x1 and x2 is the original data coordinate system, and this v1 and v2 is the new coordinate by this the principal components. Then this data point is actually expressed by alpha 1 and alpha 2, which is a projection of this point to this v1, and projection of this point to this v2, alpha 1 and alpha 2. The information of the data is actually the variance of the data. If the data do not vary at all, it actually has no information. Since the principal components are designed to capture the maximal variance, the first of few principal components explain the most of the variance in the data in many cases. In the case of these figures, the first two principal components explain more than 80% of the whole variance. So, first principal component explained almost 70% of the variance, and second one is almost 10%, and blah blah blah, and it keeps going down. So, if we accumulate it, first one and second one Up to second one, it is already explained almost in 85% of the total variance. So it actually means the whole data set actually has, you know, the four variables. By transforming, by using this, you know, the principal component, and by using the first two principal component, we can actually use only two variables instead of the four original variables by keeping more than 80% of the information. Okay. Regression with, you know, the much fewer variables by keeping the most of the information. This is, you know, the key point of the principal component regression. Okay. So the principal component regression is a regression with, you know, the first a few principal components. Okay. So linear regression is usually used. However, definitely you can use, you know, any other regression method. Okay. By just transform the data using this, you know, the principal component, then just apply to any other method. Here, keep in mind that these principal components are derived in unsupervised way. When we calculate this principal component, we do not look at y, we only look at x. So PCR assumes that the direction in which inputs are most variable, this direction is the direction that seriously associated with the output. In many applications, this assumption is reasonably working well. But it is not always efficient. Okay? Ordinary linear regression with p variables. Ordinary linear regression using the regression with p variables. However, PCR is a regression with the first k principal components. So if we use the more and more principal components, it will have the more and more flexible. So in the principal component regression, the number of, you know, the principal components, or k, is the control for flexibility. Then next is partial least square. In the coordinate transformation, generally new coordinate g is expressed by the weighted sum of the original coordinate of x. In PCR, principal component regression, we find this new direction g according to the maximal variance of x. This is a totally unsupervised way. So again, it's based on the assumption that the maximal variance of x will be correlated with the variance of the output. Sometimes it's a reasonable assumption, but in general, it's not that efficient. So in partial least square, we try to find out the new coordinate g corresponding to the maximal variance of both of x and y. This is a kind of, you know, supervised way. Okay, so this is a, you know, simple illustration. If this is in, you know, the PLS, this is a PCR. So this is, you know, just simple illustrations. So they may result in, you know, similar, but it's a little bit different. So the detailed calculation of the PLS is like this. So first, we apply a simple linear regression for each of x. So if we have the x1 and x2 and xp, we actually in the regress simple linear regression with only x1 or only x2 or only xp. Okay. Then for each of them, we calculate the coefficient. From this simple linear regression, beta 2 or the beta p, or in the generally we say this is, you know, the phi 1 and the phi 2 and the blah 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 blah. Okay. If these all axes are standardized with, you know, the in the same scale, which usually means, you know, the variance is 1, 0 mean and the variance 1. Okay, so before we apply this PLS, so So we need to, you know, the standardize this x1 and x2 and xp in the same scale, which means usually make variance of x1 equal to 1 and variance of x2 is also equal to 1. By just dividing a standard estimated standard deviation of x1 and x2. Okay? So in this setting, with a higher x with, you know, the higher correlation with y, they gonna have, you know, the higher coefficient. Then the first component of the new coordinate system is calculated by weighted sum of weighted sum of this x by their coefficient. That actually comes from each, you know, the single simple linear regression. Okay. Then the resulted one is the new direction of g. Okay. Because highly correlated x with I, with y, they gonna have, you know, the high coefficient. So the resulted direction gonna be, you know, this new direction gonna be more toward to the x with the higher correlation with y. Okay. So this is, you know, the way to, you know, to calculate, you know, the first direction. So once we get the first direction, then which is g1, then we regress y with using this beta 0 and beta 1 g1, using simple regression, we regress y with this g. Then definitely, there's going to be residual. Residual is actually y minus beta 0 minus beta 1 g1. This is, you know, the residual. Okay? So this is, you know, the rest part that is not explained by this g1. Okay? Okay, so using this, you know, the residual r, we actually, you know, the repeat this step. Instead of y, we use r, this r. Okay, then we fit each x again, then find this, you know, the coefficient phi, then we, you know, then next we find, you know, second direction g2. Okay, we just, you know, repeating these steps. Okay, this is a PLS. So in this way, we can find out, you know, the g1, the first direction g1, second direction g2 and g3, and generally up to gp. Here, actual partial least square use first m g's, m new directions. So here m is the number of the, you know, component. Then definitely each of the controlling parameter for the flexibility. If we use, you know, more g's, then means, you know, more variables. That is, it become more complex. Okay, so here is the summary. So up to now, we have actually overview the several regression methods. Polynomial regression is a linear regression with higher order terms, and spline is a regression with third order basis functions by binning the whole x range. And principal component regression is a linear regression with principal components. Actually, so a few principal components, and partial least square is a linear regression with a partially correlated component with both of x and y. Okay, so here are some references you may want to see for the more details. Okay, so I'm gonna wrap up here. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.